For the listeners of the Mariah Report, Audible is offering a free audiobook download with a free 30-day trial to give you the opportunity to check out their service. Discover what millions already have with a free audiobook. You can listen anytime, anywhere. They have over 180,000 titles to choose from. What you're going to get with Audible is 30 days of membership for free, plus a free audiobook to get you started. And even after you cancel, you get to keep the book. If you don't like the book during your free trial, you can exchange it for any other book you want. So go and get your free book, sign up for your free trial at audibletrial.com/themariahreport.
Hi.
Welcome back.
Back in time, part rainbow, part three.
Trace.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you for the international fans.
For the internationals, you know.
I'm Martin Burgess.
And I'm Dan Enriquez.
And we are discussing
one
of our favorite eras.
We've
come to realize. Now you say it out loud, when you start talking about it, you go, oh, hey,
oh my God, I really do love it. I miss it. I wish I could go back.
Oh God, that were the days.
I know. In so many ways, those were the days.
So much stress, but you look like in life in general.
Yeah.
Like teenage life.
Right.
But yeah, you look back and think, oh God.
Oh Lord. Oh, poor babies.
Yeah.
Bless their hearts.
I know.
No, it was just so fun. This was a great time to be a Mariah fan. It was a great time young teen is a great time.
I just had an epiphany.
Yeah, what?
I think that's why it was so enjoyable, because you're like kind of in this state of angst as a teenager.
Okay.
And so here we have Mariah just telling us it's going to be all right. It's normal to like have a heartbreaker and feel these things, and
yeah,
you're gonna be
okay.
Yeah,
I see that.
That's why that's probably why it connected so much.
I always thought also it was like just really gay because of the rainbow.
Yeah, there's that too.
And
yeah,
whatever. So I was always like, see, Mariah loves gays. I can be gay. I was always gay though, so I was just like, okay, yeah. See, this bitch is she's down. She got it. She knows what's up.
I think I was pretending to be straight.
Oh, I could never. I couldn't even. I'm not a good actor, so I could never do that.
I was. It was a transitional moment.
It happens to everyone. Transition to here, to there, to anywhere. We're transitioning into the second half of the album.
Yeah.
And the second half of the whole era as a whole.
Yes. And so don't forget, we're talking about how Mariah's said that there's a story in the sequencing of the album, up
right
to bottom. You have to listen to the whole thing.
Right.
So we have our theories of
who, what, when, where, and how it's going on. Yes, episode number one was just sort of like the release of the album with the album signings, blah, 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 and Heartbreaker. Part two, we went over the first half of the album from Can't Take That Away to Heartbreaker Remix.
Mm-hmm.
And now we're wrapping it on up with the second half.
Second half.
Which I really think it does change. The pace and vibe changes a little bit, but like in a good way. But we also, the lyrics change. We get much more personal in the lyrics here. And they're very heartfelt on a different type of level.
Well, like in an abstract kind of way, Heartbreaker to Heartbreaker Remix, that chunk of the album, we're kind of in a state,
Mariah and us.
Yeah. We're like in a state, like the back and forth. Like we don't know what's happening in the relationship. We're together, we're in love, we're not, we're back, we're broken up.
Okay.
We don't
know
what's up.
Right.
Heartbreaker Remix and Vulnerability Interlude.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like the Vulnerability Interlude has declared the end of that relationship. Now we're heartbroken.
Heartbroken.
In the second half of the album.
Yeah, I mean, I get that.
But if we weren't in the first half, we're in turmoil.
Yeah. See, but I think the turmoil is between two different people, whereas you think it's between just one person.
Yes.
So, like, you know, we can interpret them in different ways. But you're right. I do think that stamp of turmoil is ended.
Yeah, and now it's over.
Yeah.
And now the heartbreak sets in.
Right. So after the remix starts the interlude or whatever you would call it.
The vulnerability interlude.
The vulnerability interlude. I think that's just
that
what it's called.
Yeah.
Yeah. But she essentially just, it takes like the heartbreaker lyrics and just adds so vulnerable.
And stretches it out.
And stretches it out a little bit.
And layers it. And just and does a really cute
really
interlude.
Sort of does it. It's really, it really nice. And it's one, it's a really good segue into the second half of the album.
Yeah.
And I really like it, and it works perfectly because it, on the other end of it, is Against All Odds.
The song Against All Odds was something that I used to listen to when I was growing up and was one of my favorite songs, and I have specific memories of, like, being at certain places and, you know, and hearing that song and singing that song, and I just thought it was a very, quite a miserable, romantic song. And I saw Phil Collins when I was at... I was at a show and he was there and he was in the other studio and he came in and he listened to me sing it, and it was just a really completely random moment because who would have known we would have been together at the same place. And it was cool because he was really responsive and really complimentary. And, you know, when you grow up listening to someone and you do their song and they like it, it's a good thing. But he could have been like, please don't do that. I really, really kind of sucks.
Yeah, I kind of just had a realization.
Okay, what's that?
The vulnerability interlude, it sounds like the storm is coming.
Okay.
Now it's going to start raining.
You think?
Yeah.
Maybe it sounds like the storm has just passed.
No, it's coming because it's going to pass when the petals interlude, whatever that's called. What's that called?
Petals.
No, the...
Oh, the rainbow interlude.
The rainbow interlude. That's
comes
when it clears
petals.
Up. And then she can see the sun again, and thank God I found you.
Okay.
So now the clouds are coming in. The heart is broken, and the clouds are coming in.
Okay, I'm seeing, I'm picking up
happening?
What you're putting down.
Okay.
I'm buying that. Yeah. Actually, I don't think I ever, like, put those two things together there.
Here we are 17 years later. I'm still...
17 years later,
still
and
figuring
look at what
things
you
out.
Can
yeah.
learn. Yeah. I really never looked at it that
I
way, but I
out.
See what you're saying. Isn't that crazy? That's why I love, like, talking about Mariah.
Yeah.
I swear to you, things will pop up that make so much sense.
Okay.
Okay, but now I want to, like, really get into what songs are in between the clouds. Okay, so vulnerability, yeah. Mm-hmm. And but it ends with the rainbow, and everything in between that we're going to talk about now is yeah. in that storm.
We're in a dark phase, and it's kind of a dark part of the album too.
Yeah, and that's where the lyrics get deeper more personal.
Yeah.
Oh my God, now I'm so excited to talk about this because now I feel like I'm going to learn so much about this album that I never knew. That's so brilliant. That is so brilliant. Lambs, if you've ever, like, never, if that never crossed your mind or if it has, let us know, because I feel like that is the first time I ever could have thought of that.
Huh.
Isn't that something?
Well, I just thought of it right now.
Look at that. Well, Lambs, let us know what you feel about all of that. But I like exactly what you're saying here. Okay, so the storm comes in, Mariah's heartbroken, vulnerable.
We do a cover, which we love.
We love. And Against All Odds.
Big power ballad.
Huge. You know, I grew up listening to Phil Collins, so I knew this song.
Me too.
And I was so surprised that she had done it. Again, these are back in the day. I didn't know she had a cover on this album until I literally bought the album and popped it in my cassette. And it was like, I think it's literally the first thing on the second side of the tape. It might be. Mm-hmm. I can't quite remember. But I was so happy when she did this song because I was like, I know this song. I can relate to this song because I'm so familiar with it. Mm. But let's talk about what this song means.
This is the heartbreaker,
like
walking away.
Right, like
gone.
Right,
goodbye. We're done.
You coming back to me is against all odds.
Yeah.
It's not going to happen.
And that's just the chance. What is it like?
That's the chance I got to take.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Like you just got it. That's it. It's one of those. It is one of those walk away moments
because,
where you're just like, that's it.
Because our back and forth on again, off again isn't working.
Yeah. This really because is a whole, like, yeah. This really does tell the whole cycle of a breakup. Yes. You know, like, when I was this young, I really didn't know much about it, but I could relate because it was mirroring Mariah's heartbreak cycle.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, now I've been through my own heartbreak cycles, see...
Yes.
...exactly how it works.
Well, at the time, I had never had a real big heartbreak.
Right.
So just enjoying this song, but now, but then when it starts to happen in real life, you're like,
now I get it. Yeah. Now I'm starting to see it. Uh-huh. It all comes back to me now.
Yeah.
Okay. So Against All Odds, it is really the perfect cover song because it fits exactly what she's saying here and the pivotal point of this. So it's again, it's a genius song for this story.
Yeah.
It works so well. And I know Mariah got praise from Phil Collins because she was a little nervous. She was like, I think he said to her, they were at like a New York concert or something, radio concert or something. Mm. And he said, I really liked your version. She's like, oh, you did? I didn't know, like, blah, blah, blah. And she was like, thank you so much. I appreciate it. So like, yeah, even Phil Collins gave it a seal of approval.
Uh-huh.
I mean, come on.
Of course you would.
Of course he would. I love her voice on this because it same thing with her voice on Can't Take That Away.
Big and powerful.
Big and powerful when it needs to be. Mm-hmm. But I like that it's sort of like in her regular like speaking tone.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's not too high. It's not too low. Mm-hmm. It's like literally like right even across the board.
Mm-hmm.
And it has that sort of... You know, not raspiness to it, but almost like a rich robustness to it.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, totally.
Okay. That's why I love this song.
It's a classic standard. Like, it's a standard classic.
It's a standard classic, but not everybody could do it. Not everybody could do a song like that.
Yeah.
And again, you know, like Mariah, that's a male person singing it, but Mariah's female version take on it.
Mm-hmm.
She does it so well. You know, I was actually talking to a friend of mine who does sing, and I don't know any of this. So like singers and songwriters out there who might be listening, who know things about music.
Mm.
He was like, I was talking to him a couple weeks ago and he was like, I love the Mariah's version of Can't Take It Away because...
Of Against All Odds.
Or Against All Odds. Can't Take That Away. Against All Odds because she sings it in his key.
Ah.
But I don't know what that means, and I don't even know if that's true.
Uh-huh.
But that's what he said. Because he was like, it's really hard for a female to like bring or to sing it and keep it in his key.
Uh-huh.
And then like she brings it up and goes, you know...
Right.
You know, all over the top and whatever. And I was like, oh, okay, yeah, girl, she's amazing, right? And having no clue what he's talking about. I have no clue
uh-huh.
what you're talking about. Yeah. I'm still, as many years as I've been listening to Mariah, I still have no musical, like glossary of knowledge.
We should get somebody on to talk about the technicalities of
We really should because it's because what she does is no one can really do it.
Yeah.
It's so unique to her.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what makes her Mariah effing Carey. But anyways.
Can we talk about the Westlife version?
I mean, I guess we have to only because we have to.
So Westlife, the boy band. Having a little boy band. Boy bands are bands.
Boy bands were like coming in at this time.
Well, already. Like 90s to late 90s.
Like 98, 99. Kinds
of boy bands,
But here's again, I didn't know who Westlife was here in America.
Oh, see, they were big in Australia.
I had no clue.
Because they're an English band. We have that. Australia is a real crossover between American culture and English culture.
You get like
we get everything.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, then you would know, but I had no clue.
Mm-hmm.
I had no idea. So I was like, oh, she's doing this with these people. I have no idea who they are, but that's great. That's fine. Whatever. The video is what it is.
The budget was about $50.
Yeah, they had a few dollars to spare.
They had one of those handheld camcorders.
Yeah. I think they were like on the island of Capri or maybe somewhere.
Is that where it was?
The Mediterranean.
Yeah.
I think they shot in various locations because there are a couple of studio shots of them.
Yeah.
And then...
It's a laugh a minute.
It's really one of those things that you're just like, what was she thinking?
Yeah.
I think.
Oh, who was thinking?
Who was thinking this? Who put this together?
Yeah.
I met Westlife at a party. I think it was actually Mr. Clive Davis's after party
from one of the award shows like a couple months ago. And a friend of mine, Keith Naftali, who works at Arista, who also used to be a radio programmer, who was the first person to play my music ever, introduced me to the guys, and we just started talking. They were really cool, and my mom's Irish American, and we started talking about that. And you know, then I think it might have been Keith's suggestion that we should collaborate and do something global, you know. And I had done the cover of Against All Odds, mainly thinking about the European market and stuff, and I thought it would just be a cool thing to do, to kind of turn it into a duet and combine what they do with what I do.
Anyways, I just think that to me is probably one of the most forgettable things from the Rainbow era, I'm sorry to say.
Well, it came like right at the end as well, right?
Yeah, because in America,
the Westlife version
in America, I don't think this was an actual single.
Yeah,
but I think overseas it was an actual single, it was one of the last singles.
Yeah, it came out in Australia.
Yeah, because I know I had like imported singles, but never here in America.
Yeah.
So to me, it was just literally, you want to talk about a flash in the pan.
Yeah.
It was like in and out. And not only that, I think putting that Westlife people on it, now I'm going to get real hateful because I don't even know them. They really did a disservice to that song, because Mariah's version is nearly flawless. Uh-huh. And is really top notch.
Yeah.
There was no need to put that together. Yeah. That was just a real waste of time and money.
I agree.
So let's move on from that. We can move right along for that one.
Go look at the video on YouTube. It's pretty funny.
The video's there. They do have, don't they have a video of the Mariah only version of just concert clips from the Rainbow Tour?
Yeah.
It's back in the day, it was very rare to see that version, so yeah. I almost forget about it. But I do believe it's on her Vivo page now.
Mariah's Vivo has some good stuff.
Yeah, they finally started like giving us like the real deal.
Yeah.
So this does have an official music video to it, but it's just live concert clips of her singing it, which is perfectly fine. It's almost like what they did with Whenever You Call for Butterfly,
which
I love, by the way. I love that video, and I love that song. But
sidebar.
Okay.
Okay, back to the album.
Back to the album.
So heartbreak is gone. He's walked away.
Yep.
We're done.
Then we've come to the realization it's not going to be getting any better.
No.
It's like we're not even going to try to hold on to it.
Mm-mm, it's over.
It's against all odds.
It's out of here.
It's out of here. But
somewhere along the way, we met someone new.
Uh-huh.
My new
somewhere
friend.
Along the way, depending on who you are or how your story unfolds.
Yeah. She got right back under another.
That's right.
Didn't waste any time. Not a single song.
No, I mean, she's young. She's beautiful. Yeah. I'm not even mad. Not even mad at her.
No,
absolutely not.
Of course not.
Okay, so now we come into the Crybaby, and Crybaby is a highlight.
Highlight. But it's like people who know Crybaby love Crybaby.
Oh, love.
It is such a good freaking song.
Love it.
This is 100% has to be in the Lamb Tour.
This 100% has to be in the Lamb Tour. It has to be praised and loved by everyone because it is really masterful.
But the song from this album, I kind of have to break it down to categories of up-tempos or ballads, but if I had to pick, the song I listen to the most on this album is Crybaby, which I did with my friend Demiza, and Snoop Dogg is on there, and that's like my favorite song on this album.
Yeah. Her voice.
Yeah.
Snoop Dogg is featured in it. His feature is just right, just perfect.
Yeah.
Again, the lyrics are very visual storytelling.
Yes.
You know exactly what's going on. We've all been there.
Uh-huh.
It's perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect.
I don't know what else much to say about it. So
it's
you,
right.
You have to listen to it. You just have to
even.
There's no point talking about it. You have to listen to it.
You have to listen to it. And then the video, which again, some of these videos for the Rainbow era are very rare.
Yeah.
The Crybaby video barely came on MTV.
Yeah.
BET played it a little bit, but I was always I always tried to catch it.
This was another where I just couldn't get my hands on it.
Couldn't get your hands on it. Even here in America, it was very rare. Now, this was technically a single.
Yes.
It was a double A-side to Can't Take That Away, because that's eventually what happened.
Mm-hmm.
I love the photo shoot for this where she's in the purple shirt.
Sitting down. Cross-legged.
Bare legs. Yeah. And then the diamond shoes on.
Yes.
Love it. One of my favorite looks.
The pigtails.
Yes. One of my favorite looks. Mm-hmm. So right off the bat, visually, this is already killing me.
Mm-hmm.
Slaying me, as the children would say nowadays.
Yeah.
But her voice in it and the whole back half of this song when she's just like going and going and going.
Yep.
And it's like her voice is almost like, again, spiraling around. Mm-hmm. Like you just feel it. You just feel it. Amazing. And then, of course, this is the first time I learned what Bailey's was.
Bailey's cream.
Oh. My little gay ass didn't know.
Oh, really?
No, my mama didn't drink none of that. They didn't drink none of that in my household. We never drank liquor. It was all beer, girl.
Oh.
These were beer drinkers.
Bailey's is a thing. Was a thing in Australia. Because we had like Bailey's ice cream.
Oh.
Like it was like a branding thing.
Mm.
But you would have like Bailey's, you make a shot out of it, like a Bailey's and something. I forget what it was.
Yeah.
It's not bad.
No, it's not bad. I drink it sometimes on occasion.
It's very heavy. You want it in the winter.
Nowadays, I'm very familiar with it. But like back then, I had no clue.
Yeah.
I had no clue. I didn't know what she was talking about.
Uh-huh.
Anyways,
The storytelling in this.
Right.
Kind of reminds me of the second verse of We Belong Together.
Mm-hmm.
When the radio's on and she's like walking around the house
sipping Bailey's cream by the stereo.
Yep.
Trying to find relief.
It kind of reminds you of that. Yeah.
When suppressing the tears, what they start to flow. This next song I hear is a song I wrote. That's another reason why I feel like Jeter is such a major part in this.
Because she refers
back to a song I wrote
on the radio.
And I'm thinking that it's like My All is the song.
Yeah.
And because, you know, My All is the song that she wrote about Derek Jeter.
Because it was the last song that came out. The last album that came out.
Right. So that's why I feel like, my storyline holds true.
But Jeter is the heartbreaker. Cheating around.
Okay, but yeah, but in, yes, he is, but... in the beginning, like the heartbreaker is there, but she has already gotten the new guy.
No, see, I think
but
it's
now
the one
she's
guy.
Finally saying, okay, well, it's either one guy or two guys. We were gonna spend all the time arguing over it when really it's probably nothing of the above.
Because in this song, Crybaby, she says, okay, it's 5 a.m., I still can't sleep. She took medicine. Late at night,
like a little child
wandering around alone in my new friend's home. She just met this guy. He's new. He's not five songs ago.
Okay, I guess.
So that he won't know that she still cries. So like she's in the she's in the heartbreak now.
I know. She's in the middle of the storm here. She's really feeling it. Like she has her new man. But even though I thought she met her new man before, maybe she didn't. But the new man is here, but she's still heartbroken over the old heartbreaker.
Yeah.
Okay. I get it. And she's taking the bubble bath, and she's throwing the Oreos around,
mm-hmm.
and she's making a complete mess with the Fruity Pebbles.
I know.
I can't handle it.
She's clumsy.
But she does look really good. But how about the beeper, the pager, the two-way pager?
Uh-huh.
Oh, Mariah thought she was full on technology back then, girl. Look at it now.
It's all in the trash.
Can you believe it?
Here's the thing. The storytelling in this song is just so much fun. It's a fun song.
It is. It's so fun. Yeah. But I mean, aside from the storytelling, I think the vocals on this and the way that she just wails about mm-hmm. and like just belts out, I just think that, and it's not like, you know, it's not like a ballad belting, yeah. you know, it's hard to describe because I'm not musically inclined, but I think that's what really kills me, because I still get chills listening to the ending vocal runs song.
It's a primal scream.
Yeah.
Like she's in pain.
Yeah.
She's really in pain over this guy. She can't sleep anymore. She's suffering in the middle of the night.
Yeah. Suffering in the middle of the night, even nothing. After she has changed her number.
Yeah.
And then your cousin called to say, trying to reach me, probably because you know that I'm with someone new.
Yeah, she can't get away. Yeah. That's it. Yeah, yeah.
That's it.
Yes.
That's it. It's just
the then last Saturday, your cousin called to say, now it's all coming back to me.
It's all coming back now.
Uh-huh. She can't get away.
She can't stop like yearning for this old love.
But even that's torture when you know they're trying to contact you and mm-hmm. you're trying to get over it.
But you got to change your number.
Yeah.
But you got to do it. Some you have to put your foot down.
But that wasn't enough because the cousin called.
Yeah, but you know, but I actually think it was the sister, because you know she was very friendly with Derek Jeter's sister.
Oh yeah, and isn't she still is?
She, I think she still is. Yeah. Yeah. Mm hmm. Mm hmm. Mm-hmm. So how you doing? Yeah. So I just love the like. I feel like she's the miserable. Lyrics are very real here.
Yeah, she's very miserable.
Very miserable. Miserable.
Like it's a fresh breakup.
Like going through it.
Yeah.
And like, it's very interesting though. Like, even though she has a new man, like he does not faze her at all. Like she's just like, yeah, whatever. He's asleep in the bed, bitch.
Yeah.
He ain't got the good D.
But she likes him enough to tiptoe around.
And yeah.
Doesn't want to wake him up.
Gosh, no.
Meanwhile, she's having this like secret struggle.
Right.
All by herself.
This internal struggle of heartbreak and, oh, the stress.
Yeah.
But anyways, I just love this song all the way around through and through. I am glad that it finally got a video. I'm glad that it finally got a lot of radio play.
Yeah.
It did fairly well on the Billboard charts. I want to say it went top 20.
Yeah.
R&B wise. So that was good. And I know that I'm sure Mariah is very, very proud of it. Because I bet she loves this one. Because she performed this on the Rainbow Tour, which was a very interesting stage production, if you ask me. But we'll talk about that at another time. I just love this song all the way around.
It's a highlight of the album,
yeah,
for sure,
definitely. Definitely, I could listen to this any day of the week.
Yeah.
This to me is like a timeless song.
I was about to say, it still sounds fresh.
So fresh,
yeah.
So good. And here we are even 20 years later and Snoop Dogg is still like relevant.
Yeah.
Like it works so well.
Yeah,
it's such a timeless song.
Yeah.
I love it. Can we just let Mariah know, like, this song is effing amazing?
Yes, definitely. Like,
somebody let her know. Please.
I know. How do we tell her how good it is?
I mean, I don't know. You just got to tell her on here, like, shout out. Hey, Mariah, Crybaby's effing amazing.
Because she never sings it anymore.
No, she doesn't. Yeah, it's sort of a long song, though, honestly.
Well, give me the car ride medley version of it.
Well, yeah. I mean, I don't
Mix
know.
Mix it up in something.
She should definitely bring that one out of the repertoire
once
or twice, because the lambs would gag over it.
Oh,
gag over
drop.
It. Okay, so there's our Crybaby moment.
Suggestion
we love it.
For the Lionel Richie tour.
Hashtag suggestion.
Since they're not her fans anyway.
Right.
I mean, they're his fans. Her true fans are going to be the ones there.
Right.
So give us some entertainment.
Give us something. Pull something out. Give us a rainbow moment outside of, like, you know, Heartbreaker and Thank God I Found You.
Yeah.
Even though we love both of them. But, okay, so now here comes another very, very fun song after Crybaby. Now she's going and saying, "Did I Do That?"
Yeah.
Featuring Mystical. See, now here's like, look at these two songs back to back.
Yeah.
I really love both of these songs, but you can see how classic and timeless Crybaby is
mm-hmm.
with Snoop Dogg. Here we are 17 years later, still fresh as a daisy.
Yeah.
Yet if you listen to Mystical on whole song of Did I Do That, it sounds like it's from the 90s.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
First of all, nobody knows who Mystical is anymore. Nobody. No. You, honey, nobody. Do you know the other day I said to somebody, oh, do you know who Paula Abdul is? And they were like, no. And I was like, I gotta go. I gotta go. I gotta leave. I can't be here. So imagine asking somebody,
do you know who Mystical is?
You're not gonna get a response. So,
well, this song in the storyline, I don't mind this song. It's kind of,
no, I like this
song. It's funnish. It's fun.
Because here in the storyline, she's like, I can't even believe I wasted my time with you.
With that guy.
You're right.
Like now she's over
the old heartbreaker. She's like, this is absurdly absurd that I even boohooed over you.
She's come to her senses.
She has come to her senses. I like the song.
But she got there via Crybaby. Just like let it all out.
Right. Right.
You have to go through it to get to this point.
Honey, you got to go through the storm to get to the other side.
Yeah. See, now the rainbow's starting to appear.
Right. She's finally coming out of the storm. Basically, that's what's happening. But I do love some of the lyrics in here. And you want to talk about a shady song.
Super shady.
Super shady. Like, people don't realize this is shade, girl.
The whole thing is shade.
The whole thing. Yeah. Every lyric. I mean, it's the lyrics, again, are very well done. I mean, they do go with that mystical beat perfectly. Yeah. It's almost like she almost sings in a breakdown type of style.
Right.
But girl, when she starts talking about, you know, I gave you all my trust and intimacy and you just threw it away.
Yeah.
And then, ooh, no, when she starts talking about, something.
But now that's all in the past. And then when I think of you, I just laugh. Like, that's when you know you're over it. You're like, oh my God, did I really
do
that?
Yeah, I just cannot believe it. There's a part in the song where she says,
it
was all in the past. I think of you, I just left. My friends must have thought I was high because I've given someone so much worth my time.
Uh-huh.
And I was just like, girl, she is putting this man under the bus.
Yeah.
Under the bus.
Done with him.
And now I'm sitting here thinking, well, Derek Jeter is a fucking fool.
Yeah.
Allegedly, this is the heartbreaker character. It's a character we're talking about.
Yeah, but we know Jeter just couldn't handle the media attention.
Yeah, well, we know what really happened, but, you know.
But at the same time, okay, so, a while ago, I was with some friends, and we were talking about, I think the Super Bowl was on, and we were talking about, the question came up, why do all these football players, athletes, no offense to athletes, hook up with models? Like, what is that all about? You know, all these athletes have model girlfriends.
Oh, right, right, right. Like Giselle and that man.
Yeah, exactly. That was the exact reference point. What was her name? Tom Brady and Giselle.
Oh, yeah, Giselle.
Yeah.
I know her.
Anyway, I said, I think it's because intellectually they're on the same level.
Oh, so you're throwing them all under the bus.
Whole
lot of them.
If you're an athlete, you're concentrating on chasing the ball, hitting the ball.
There's very much like a dog.
If you're shady.
I'm kidding.
Model two, you're just focusing on walking. Like, there's no
One foot in front of the other.
There's nothing intellectually stimulating about those professions. Not there's anything wrong with them. Like, good for them making all that money.
I wish I was one of
other. Please, I wish. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mariah is a musician who's interested in the arts, and that's much more intellectually stimulating.
Yeah.
So I bet the relationship between Mariah and Jeter was strange because Mariah is a wealth of information and super intelligent.
And very, very smart.
And here's this man who spent his life chasing balls.
Because now we're
about to get into this. They probably had good chemistry, though.
They had great chemistry together, like great sexual chemistry and like whatever. And then you throw in, you know, Mariah's insecurities about biracial and growing up and things of that nature. And it was just a perfect match in theory.
Yeah.
But good on paper. But like when you get to, you know, the dinner table at night and have nothing to talk about.
Conversation is painfully weak. We were much better off
when you didn't speak.
Yeah.
Exactly.
She reveals a lot about that relationship. So I can imagine that being the Jeter relationship.
Oh, absolutely.
And his friends too being all dumbasses.
Oh, the whole lot of them.
Yeah.
Stupid as fuck. Uh-huh. Excuse my language. I don't know why I'm cursing. But overall, I love that song. for the storytelling.
Yeah.
Because it gives Mariah's view on that relationship from what I take.
Yeah.
And it plays perfectly in this story, this rainbow story.
But also, if you're following the album, you're kind of getting pulled into the emotions as well. So it kind of pulls you out.
Yes.
With her.
Yeah, because like, okay, now you're like, oh my God.
We're over this.
Now, yeah. Right? Because really, I've been with some people and I've been like, oh my God, what hell?
What
like,
was
that
I thinking?
Man is crazy as F. Yeah. And what was I thinking? Uh-huh. I think we've all been there.
Yeah. That's so part of growing up, though.
Yeah, it is. Because you have to go through the crazy to be able to recognize it.
Kiss a lot of toads.
Right, exactly.
Drugs,
unless you're crazy yourself, then like you're...
The problem.
The problem. Yeah. But...
I've probably dated people where they're like, oh, did I date that guy?
Well, I hope I'm not that guy,
I'm sure I am somewhere.
Yeah. But we've all been there. So it's a song, like, even though it sounds like it's from 1902, literally, it is a fun song.
Yes.
And I'm glad it's there because it's really good.
Okay, let's take a break.
Let's take a quick break.
And then we'll wrap up. Oh, I'm sad.
No!
Let's take a break. Hey, Dan.
Yes, Martin.
I want to tell everybody about audible.com.
It's
the world's largest collection of audio books. That means you don't have to read books anymore.
They got everything. It's like the online library.
Yeah, pretty much.
Like, come on.
Yeah.
It doesn't get any better.
And the best part is for you guys at home, we've hooked you up with a deal. Go to audibletrial.com/TheMariahReport and you get a free audiobook, 30-day trial, cancel anytime, keep the book if you don't want to stay signed up. And
you can return the book if you just decide that you don't like it and want to try something new.
See?
That's the best thing. Because, like, I hate buying a book and I'm, like, 3 pages in
and
I can't deal with it.
Uh-huh.
And then I got to toss it, recycle it.
Not at Audible.
Not at Audible.
Click, click, click.
That's why I love Audible.
Go to audible.com. Oh, sorry, audibletrial.com/TheMariahReport. For your 30-day trial and a free book, and you can keep it.
Do it now.
We're back.
Thank you. Welcome back.
Okay, we're about to round out the album.
Round out the album and swing it on home.
Okay.
Now, next.
This is a big song.
This is big. This is a big, big song.
A big lamb song.
Big lamb song, big Mariah song.
Yeah.
And we have to do it justice. We have to really dive deep into this one because there's so much going on in this song.
And the song is Petals, Petals.
Mm-hmm.
When I was originally listening to this album, so I wasn't a lamb yet.
Right.
I was, like I said, I was on the hater wagon somehow.
Uh-huh.
I was being forced to listen to this album. I heard this song and I was like, oh my God. Like, someone gets me. Like,
yeah.
It really was one of those songs.
Yeah.
Because whatever story she's telling, like the poetry of this song, and it's really just a long poem.
It really is.
There's nothing's the same. There's no verse, no chorus that's the same.
To me, the songs I feel closest to that I've written are the ones that are not necessarily about traditional love situations, but things that are more personal, like songs that most people don't ever hear, but the real fans who actually buy the albums and listen to the album cuts. Like, there's a song from Butterfly called Close My Eyes. That's one of the more personal songs I've written. And when I listen to it, it's like, I don't know, I feel a really strong connection to it. And a lot of my fans talk about that song as well. And then there's a song called Petals on the Rainbow album, which is definitely one of the most honest lyrics I've ever written, but it's not a love song. So I guess people, you know, I know how to write love songs and they're real when they come from me. It's just that the most impactful things for me to listen to are the songs where I just, and they usually take like 10 minutes to write, the real honest things that are bad stuff that went on in my past or whatever I'm going through at that moment.
The essence of it, I was like, wow, she knows me.
Right. I got that only from like the first little part of the lyrics.
Yes.
Like, I often wondered if there's ever
been a perfect family.
Yeah, exactly.
And I think anybody who comes from a fractured household knows what that means.
Which I think there's a majority of people out there are. Like, nobody's life is perfect.
Mm-hmm.
But just the way that she opens up that song so beautifully,
mm-hmm.
the production, the everything is so beautiful. And then those first few words, if you're not sucked in by that and you're not like willing to listen to get more mm-hmm. of the story, mm-hmm. I don't know what's wrong with you.
I've often wondered if there's ever been a perfect family. I've always longed for undividedness and such stability.
I think the overall theme of the Rainbow album is being vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
Which is very difficult to do.
Yeah, well, when you're in a relationship, you know, especially with a, you know, a partner or a lover,
yeah.
you have to be vulnerable
yeah.
to a certain, and that is the overall theme. One of the overall themes of this is vulnerability.
Exactly, but in Petals, I think she's allowing vulnerability uh-huh. to be the dominant force in the storytelling.
Yes.
Because she's talking about coming from a fractured family. And we live in a world where it's not really okay to talk about how you feel about things.
Right. Especially, so, let's go back in time, because that's what we're 99. Doing here. This is yeah. 1999. These are still the 90s.
Yeah.
Things, you can't talk about that. Like, even Mariah, you know, being biracial, that was a topic that she pushed a lot because she wanted people to know. But yeah. it still was not something that you just randomly talk about openly yeah. and publicly.
Yeah. But here she is talking about her fractured family and how what... She's always longed for undividedness
and stability. Stability.
And when she says that, you're like, do you know what? That's what I want too.
I mean, that's my life right there.
Yeah.
Like who, like, you know what I mean?
Yes.
Like, that's why I say, like, if those lyrics or, you know, those words don't pique your interest into this song, like, I just don't get it. I don't know where, I'm not going to be able to relate with you on like a life level.
Yeah.
But that's why I love this song.
Well, I think why it's so powerful is that we feel these things, but she's applying language to it.
Right.
And now we can articulate what that is.
Right. Yeah.
It's not just this mysterious thing we're feeling. Now we know what we're feeling.
Right. She's putting the words
yeah.
in your mouth, yeah. basically.
Well, but also normalizing it. Now you're not such a weirdo.
Right. There's relatability there. You know somebody else is doing things.
Yeah.
You know, and even as open as she is in this song, it's also a very, very lyrically coded song.
Yes.
Like, you know. Very abstract. She has to give you a little bit of everything, yet keep a little bit of everything at yeah. the same time. And that's one. That's the balance in this song, or the tug of war in this song,
mm-hmm.
that also works really, really well. Because even in your own life, just overall in general, you know, you want to be vulnerable and give yourself out to other people. But at the same time, you got to keep, you know, yourself together, because people will stab you in the back at the drop of a dime.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
So you got to, like, you got to beware.
Yeah.
You got to know what's going on. So there's that delicate balance.
This also is in the vein of looking in, close my eyes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Petals, where you get to see behind the diva, I guess.
The diva, like the big hair, the short skirts, whatever.
You get to know Mariah.
Yeah. And I Close My Eyes is like yeah. my favorite song of all time, but like this is right along next to it.
Yeah, but then it just reaffirms that she is me. Like we're the same right. person.
Yeah.
She can just sing really well.
And write beautiful songs.
And look better and all that stuff.
You know, yeah. and, you know, have flawless skin and yeah. blah, blah, blah. Okay, so let's start in the beginning. The song is called Petals, but the really only flower petal things or what we get is from the first, when a flower taught her how to pray and blah, blah, blah. Now, I think, because again, this is all a story.
Yeah.
But in this particular part of the story, I think that's her sister.
I think that too.
I think it's her sister, Allison, and you know, how one that you think is, you know, so amazing, you look up to, can literally blow away in the wind and be gone.
Crumble under the pressures of life.
Yes. There you go. There you go.
Couldn't do it.
Right.
Because Allison wasn't able to, you know, stay off drugs. Obviously, Mariah at one point had money coming in, so she didn't have to do whatever she was doing back then. But she just wasn't able to be strong throughout life.
Yeah.
And started flailing in the wind.
Like golden petals scattering.
Yeah. But this, this little section, this like opening section applied to my life as well.
Yeah. There's so many relatable parts.
Yeah.
I know a dandelion with golden petals scattering in the wind.
Yeah. Like this could be about my mother. Like my mother.
Yeah.
That's our relationship.
There you go.
Like when I was young, my mother and I were really tight. But then as I grew, and my mother taught me how to pray. Like she was the teacher in my life.
Right, right.
But then as I grew, like if she got sick with cancer and then just went completely like derailed. Never a drug addict or anything, but just like checked out of being a mother.
Right. I see that.
And just like the life was too much for her now.
Right.
And so I was like, Mariah, I'm like on my own now.
There you go.
No, I wasn't like actually on my own, but like.
But you're like, the connection I gotta make this happen for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow, how does she know that?
Right.
But
and how does she know how to put it into such words where even though it's a different situation with her, but you see exactly what it is. The feeling is still there.
But she's witnessing it.
Right.
And it's painful.
It is painful because it's somebody you love. It's, you know, it's your family. Yeah. It's your people.
And like, and when you watch something you have, like whatever it is, get blown in the wind, you just see it. You can't do anything about it.
Right?
The wind took it away.
I mean, it could be a dollar bill. You know when a dollar bill flies out your hand and you'd be like, But but you gotta just watch it go.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, she misses her dandelion and she loves you, you know?
Oh, I know. And this, I don't have to get too deep into this because I could really start crying. Same thing. Say the second verse, same thing.
Yeah.
It's like too painful to try and reconnect.
Oh, man. Anyway, the song is just really deep.
It's
almost like if we go into all of it, we'd be sitting here boohoo crying.
I know.
It's really a lot. And again, this is a song that only the fans know. But if more people knew about it, I swear they would look at Mariah very differently.
Well, yeah, this thing, people don't know about it.
You know?
Yeah.
It's everybody knows Mariah for the heartbreaker, fantasy, dream lovers.
Yeah.
If they really got behind and looked at all of these other songs, they would be like, oh my God, she is me. Mm-hmm. I get her. Mm-hmm. I understand. And it's really a shame that things like this go unnoticed.
What's great about it is that if Mariah told me her, like the actual story of this, and then I told her my life story, this would be the common thread. Like, oh, I get it.
Yeah.
Like, we'll get each other.
Right.
And that's what this is. This is that middle ground where you can be abstract and like, oh, I get what you're talking about.
Yeah. I mean, that's the magic of music and of word.
Yeah.
You know, it transcends, it makes you relate in ways that, you know, you just wouldn't imagine.
Mm-hmm.
It connects people. I mean, that's overall, music connects people.
But this first section is like one chapter of it, but it ends with, but I miss you, mm-hmm. dandelion,
mm-hmm.
and even love you. And that's it.
Yeah, this song has like its own story arc and own chapters.
Yeah.
Like, because it's like this, from the golden petals, the dandelion,
mm-hmm.
and then she goes into the patriarch.
Mm-hmm.
Which, you know, very going into that, she said she went in young, predictably, resigned to spend my life within a maze of misery. And that's her, like...
Marrying Tommy. The patriarch of Sony, music.
And not only of that, but I also think for her personally, she's always sought stability.
Yeah.
Tommy is stability.
Yeah.
Tommy is the most, probably the most, even though he was not right for her and did a lot of things wrong because he didn't know what the hell he was doing with this young girl. She didn't know what she was doing with this man, but what she sought was that stability.
Yeah.
And predictably, she went right into it. I mean, I feel like if I was her age, I probably would have done the exact same thing.
Yeah.
I would not have been able to say, no, this isn't right. Yeah. It's not going to work out. What I'm seeing in my eyes is the strong, you know, protector, the man who's going to
make her dreams come true.
Make my dreams come true and comfort me and bring me to that quote unquote perfect family life.
Yeah.
You know, married, you know, blah, blah, blah.
There's an unauthorized biography about Mariah. It came out around this time, maybe.
Right.
I can't remember what it's called. It has a pink cover and she's got the pink.
Yeah, and she has the paparazzi dress. Uh-huh.
The Tommy chapters, when they met, after reading, I was like, oh, I get it.
Yeah.
Like you kind of fall in love with him a little bit.
Yeah.
After all the things he did for her, like to get her to where she is.
Right. And yes, their relationship really messed Mariah up. But again, she was so young.
Yeah.
She didn't know any better.
Mm-mm.
She really, if you were in her position, I don't think you could take a step back and look at the bigger picture.
Yeah.
Just because of where she was at and what she wanted in her life.
Yeah.
So it just was an unfortunate thing. But I think looking into the future here, everything turned out just how it was meant to be. And,
yeah.
You know, luckily Mariah and Tommy came out of that relationship remotely unscathed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's mm-hmm. obviously side effects that linger on,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
but everybody's going to be okay.
Yeah. Thing is, she's addressing it in this song.
Mm-hmm. Right. Which is just, I just love when she gives us this real peek into her life.
Yeah.
I just love it because that's what connects me. So then she goes on to, you know, Tommy, blah, blah, blah. And then she talks about little brother and little sister.
Yeah.
And bonding and, you know, all of that. And I believe that those were Tommy's younger children.
Mm-hmm.
That were a little younger than Mariah, if not around the same age.
Mm.
So she spent a lot of time with them and they became like sisters and yeah. brothers and sisters.
Uh-huh.
So that's where I think all that comes into play. And, you know, sort of like...
Well, this verse is like a love letter to them. But she stayed so long, finally she fled to save her sanity. She knew she had to get out of there.
She had to get out of there. Her head would have exploded.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
So she had to leave it all behind, like a clean break.
Right. I mean...
Which sounds like she's like leaving a cult.
Right. Or I was going to say like, I mean, this may be a little over dramatic, but like when a mother flees like an abusive husband yet leaves her kids, which is probably one of the worst things you could do. But sometimes in certain instances, it might have to go that way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like a hard thing to do. Maybe that's over the top. Because it's rough, but, you know, everybody has a situation.
Yeah.
I'm just saying. So, you know, she...
But she was like, I just had to get out of this.
She had to
go.
This
is not for me.
And it has nothing to do with you guys.
Yeah.
My little brother, little sister, I still love you.
Uh-huh.
Right? Okay. So that's the one chapter. So we've had the Mariah's growing up chapter.
Getting married chapter.
And now we have this sort of like, I guess this is the final chapter, which is... I would say her current life at this point in 1999.
Yeah. Like a free spirit.
Right.
Navigating the world as a young woman, a professional musician.
Yep.
Uber famous beyond belief.
Right.
And trying to be a person.
Yeah. Right. And how do you do that?
How do you do that?
How do you do that when you've come from that, you know, broken childhood,
yeah.
and then you get into a situation you ultimately end up gaining nothing from that, and now you're like a child again,
mm-hmm.
yet you're a grown woman
mm-hmm.
With worldwide success. How do you make it work?
Yeah.
How do you do it?
Most people who become famous at an early age experience that fame and know what that's like, but I didn't because I was kind of really tucked away. So I was coming out of it and sort of like a wide-eyed kid, like, woo, I'm having fun. Not that I was going wild, but to the public, they thought that I was. But I got involved in some situations that weren't necessarily healthy for me. You know what I mean? So I think that coming out of it and what I'm hoping for in the new millennium is like a rainbow symbolizes hope.
So many I consider says to me
lyrics in there are, I considered so many closest to me, turned on a dime, sold me out dutifully. I think that little paragraph right there is specifically about her friendship with Walter A. Because like he apparently told a secret to Tommy or something.
Yeah.
And you know, allegedly this is in my head. I think that he told Tommy that she was seeing Derek Jeter, the Heartbreaker character.
Oh.
And then she was like, how dare you? And that's why they're never working together again, because that's just me. Yeah. That's what I infer from that little section of lyrics right there.
Well, I feel like it was a common problem. You make friends with someone, they tell the tabloid a story. Could they get 10 grand?
I mean, that could be much more vague and not specific about Walter.
Yeah.
I just
Or a reoccurring problem.
Right, a reoccurring problem. Mm-hmm. Because, again, you're surrounded by all these people. Yeah. Who do you know who's, like, really your friend and who's not?
Oh, you don't. Back in the day, when I first came to New York, I was working in publicity, media, dealing with the media, publicity, the whole world. Fake as shit, the whole thing.
Yeah.
Horrible.
Oh, I can imagine.
A total nightmare.
It's not.
I had to flee to save my sanity.
You got to.
Yeah.
You got to. You know, because some people can deal with that because they can like compartmentalize it and just like click out.
Yeah.
Some people cannot. I'm not one of those people.
Yeah.
You know, uh-huh. I'm not going to be able to deal with phoniness.
But I can imagine Mariah's on a whole other level of that.
Oh, of course. It's heightened.
Yeah.
It's super heightened.
Yeah.
But that's. That's sort of like the negative that comes with this career and this industry that she's in,
mm-hmm.
Which is really unfortunate, but I mean, I guess it has to happen.
Mm-hmm.
So the song wraps up, I missed a lot of life, but I'll recover, blah, 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 all that. Just really great things of her looking up again.
Reflecting.
Thinking, you know, all of these things have happened to me, but look where I am.
Yeah.
I will be okay. I will preserve my sanity.
Yeah.
And then it's just beautiful. The song closes out so beautifully.
It's such a great piece. It's a great piece of work to know where she is at that time in her life. But you can just see that she's also so very self-aware and self-reflective
mm-hmm.
and understands what's happening.
Yeah. Which is a real talent.
Well, this is why people...
Mental talent.
Yeah. Well, this is why people get depressed and anxious and all kinds of mental problems, because they're feeling something, but they have no language.
Yes.
They're just feeling it, and that can be manifests as depression or anxiety. Whereas Mariah can really pinpoint what's wrong, what's upsetting her.
Mm-hmm.
And when you do that, then you can find your way out of it.
Exactly. Then you know how to like get out of it, work with it, mm-hmm. work around it.
Understand it.
Understand it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's why Mariah is literally one of the best songwriters out there. Because when stuff like this comes up, I mean, you just, not anyone can do this.
Mm-hmm.
Not anyone, not everyone can do this.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm just glad that she put something like this on this album.
Yes.
Because it's so good.
And I don't think without this song, I think it probably changed my life. Because without it, I wouldn't have signed on to the Mariah wagon.
I hear that.
And I wouldn't have, here I am.
Here you are, almost 20 years later.
Hey, New York
still
City.
Still obsessed with this bitch.
Yeah.
But it is songs like this that really pull you into her.
Mm-hmm.
Pull you into her. I sort of got this message from earlier songs of hers.
Yeah.
But that's why I continue to stay with her, because of this.
Yeah.
So when these things do pop up on these albums, it literally brings me back to day one of why I love her.
Yeah.
It really does. So, shout out to Mariah, the best bitch in the game.
Yeah.
The best bitch.
This is such a great song.
It is such a great song. Now, we did went into an in-depth analysis of the lyrics, but that song really needed it.
Yeah.
But
you can't skim this song.
You know, it's just so good. But let's also pair this with the performance from the Rosie O'Donnell Show.
Which we have talked about
in one of our earlier episodes.
It's so good.
But it's such... It's one of the best performances she's ever given, I think. It's probably in my top 10 of all time favorites.
She's just sitting on the chair with her mic.
And they have, like, you know, because there's the rain that you hear in the background, and they have, like, those tubes of, like, water with bubbles and everything. Yeah. And then the live instrumentation.
Oh, that's what made it.
And the drums and everything. And then the backup singers. And just her simple beauty and, like, just naturalness. Just her look.
Yeah.
It was amazing. It was amazing.
The delivery was great. Just when you were saying all that, I just realized she should have done that in the park with the Philharmonic Orchestra.
Wouldn't that have been something?
And just made the music this big body of music behind it.
Yes. I wonder if, I mean, I bet that crossed her mind, but she went in a slight different direction with looking instead. Mm-hmm. You know, but it's in the same vein.
Yes.
So I bet that did cross her mind.
Yeah.
You know? Which would have been an epic performance.
Oh my God.
Gosh. Because here's the thing. She performed this also on the Rainbow Tour. But in all honesty, maybe because it's just a big setting and you're 35,000 people around you, it didn't touch me the way the Rosie O'Donnell performance touched me.
Yeah, all those Rosie shows are the best. Yeah. Even the Close My Eyes Rosie O'Donnell.
Oh, the best.
The best.
Oh, the best, because she's performed
Close My
Eyes. Touches
me more than the album version.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's so it's, you're taking a raw song and you're giving it a raw vocal like that.
Yeah.
And it's just, I can't even say how good it is.
Yeah.
It's so
ethereal.
Good.
Mm-hmm.
So I just love it. But that performance right there goes down in history of like one of the best.
Yeah.
Because it's one of the best songs and she just did her damn thing right there. Because that's what it's all about. It's not about all the lights, the camera action, the flashy clothes, the titties, all of that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sit down and just sing me this song, girl.
Mm.
And we're all good. We're all good.
Yeah. This is where you see her as an artist, because no matter what your medium is, whether you're a painter, a story writer, a vocalist, that's how you let the energy of whatever you're feeling, happiness, turmoil, sadness, that's how you let it come out.
Mm-hmm.
So this is her just letting all that stuff out.
Yeah.
And doing that, she's like, lets it out of all of us.
Right. So it's not just helping her, but everybody else.
Yeah. And this wouldn't make sense if you don't have these, if you haven't experienced what she's talking about or feeling it, it wouldn't make no sense to you.
Right. I mean, there has to be something, but I think it's a common thing, a lot of these emotions.
Well, that's the thing. It's so common. Nobody talks about it.
Right.
She's giving you permission to feel it.
Right. Which is why I thought it was a genius move of her to perform that on Rosie O'Donnell, which was the biggest talk show of the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
She was putting it out there to be like vulnerable and saying, it's okay. We can all use a good cry sometimes.
Gosh,
you know?
I wish she would come back because she's not vulnerable no more. She's like so locked up.
Well, I think that has a lot to do with a lot of things.
Yeah. This is where she shines, being vulnerable.
Yeah, this is where she shines. I agree. Oh, man. Okay, let's continue with our therapy session here.
Yeah.
and talk about the Rainbow Interlude,
which I love.
Beautifully flows out of Petals.
The rain is clearing up.
Yes.
Now,
as we have discovered how this all works here.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mariah, for giving us this 17 years later. But now the sun is coming up.
Like, okay, so
the
Petals,
rain is stopping.
Yeah, Petals is like the exhale. Like, it's out. It's done. Here's where I'm at. Here's what's happened.
Yeah.
I'm wet from the storm.
Mm-hmm. You've made it through the rain.
You've made it through the rain, but I'm down in the dumps. But when you hit the bottom, when you're at the bottom, that's when it starts to go back
up. Right, because there's nowhere else to go.
Yeah, and so
but
this,
up.
Yeah. And so she knows that there's the other side of the rainbow,
right,
of the storm.
Mm-hmm. Because she's been in the dark before.
Uh-huh.
She's been in the deep thing,
yeah,
you know, childhood, marriage. She's been there. She knows that this little heartbreak,
yes,
is a laugh off,
uh-huh,
like she said in Did I Do That?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, And no matter what it is, a heartbreak, a divorce, you know, the loss of a loved one, whatever it can be, there's always the other side of it.
If you look hard enough, a rainbow will appear.
After every storm.
If you look hard enough,
a rainbow will appear.
What'd she say? I know there's a rainbow.
For me to follow, to get beyond my sorrow.
Yeah. So the thunder, what is it? Precedes the sunlight.
Look at me singing. Y'all are really getting me here. I can't believe y'all are getting this voice singing. So you will not catch that anywhere else.
So I'll be all right. So she knows. I'll know I'll be all right.
Yeah.
If I can just find that rainbow's end.
That's correct. That is correct.
Which means you can, like, that's almost like the light at the end of the tunnel. Like, okay, I'm through it.
Mm-hmm.
But also, you know, 29-30 is a, you're having a transition in life in general as well.
That is a transitional moment.
It is.
Yeah. So she's because just... you're going into essentially adulthood, even though, like, in your 20s, you're an adult.
But the 20s are,
but
like,
the 20s are your learning. Yeah. That's where you learn. Uh-huh. But, and then, like, in your 30s, you know, you got to, like, know what's happening. You got to be, like, one. Yeah. You got to be together here.
You got to start to...
Put the pieces together.
Yeah.
Or
climb out.
Yeah. Or, you know, just...
Figure it out. Yeah.
You know where your rainbow is. Mm-hmm. That's all you need.
I feel like the vocals come in a little bit hard in the interlude.
Really? I don't think I've noticed that.
Just a little hard.
You think something was wrong with the mastering of the tracks?
It almost could have been that. Just my personal opinion.
Okay. It could have been.
I quite never know when to start singing along.
Oh.
Do you know what I mean?
Oh, I thought you meant like they come in like really loud or something.
No. Like it's the strings and then zoom.
Oh, just like singing. It's just a fast like, transition.
I can't catch the beat.
Oh, I don't think I've ever had that problem. Maybe I'll have to go home and sing the whole album in my bedroom and see if it happens. And don't give me, I will. I don't know why you're laughing.
I think we all do that.
But I want to say that I love you and I'm very happy and grateful to you all for being such devoted fans. And so we want to do a little a cappella version of a song from my new album. It's not really a song, it's just an interlude, but it's kind of a positive message. So we wanted to sing it for you tonight. I know there is a rainbow for me to follow, to get beyond my sorrow. Thunder precedes the sunlight, so I'll be alright if I can find that rainbow's end.
Sing.
I know there is a rainbow for me to follow, to get beyond my sorrow. Thunder precedes the sunlight, so I'll be alright if I can find.
That was just a beautiful little therapy session there, Martin. I loved it. And then we end on the Thank God I Found You.
Because we've got Lewis now. She's into him.
Now, yeah, exactly.
She released all this angst so now she can get into him, like focus and have fun.
Right. Now she's like, everything's good. I've come out. I see the rainbow. Thank God I found you.
She got herself a little Latin lover.
I like a Latin lover. Mm-hmm. That's cute. Okay, so this essentially is dedicated to him.
Yeah.
Actually, I think the whole album is actually dedicated to him, technically. In her liner notes, I do believe she dedicates...
Yeah.
Maybe the whole album to him? I can't quite remember. Something, or I think she dedicates it to the fans. And then Thank God I Found You is dedicated to him.
Yeah.
Because, you know, in the inside cover of the album, it says, you know, this is the story, the roller coaster story, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. But, you know, it says that. And I'm not saying blah, 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 as if it doesn't matter. I'm just saying because I don't know the words off the top of my head anymore.
So thank God I found you. Such a strong declaration of love.
Very strong.
Like, she felt like dying.
Right?
Until he came along.
Very strong.
Was it that bad?
Really?
But when you are heartbroken, you kind of just want to go up and die.
Yeah, you're just like, oh, just take me now, Lord. Yeah. Just take me. I can't do it.
I'm just going to lie in my bed.
I can't do it anymore. Yeah. You know, so I'm I just think she was trying to write like a cute little love song, which is what it turned into being. Uh-huh. The one thing about this song, because I like this song, but I don't. Like, I like this song, like, when it randomly comes up.
It's kind of, it's cheesy.
I don't go to the song to be like, oh, hey. I
want to hear this. Yeah. Well, it's got the 90s sound, because we have the boy band.
Because you got the boy band. 98
and degrees.
And Joe sounds great in it and everything, and they all sound good.
Yeah.
The video's cute. The video's nothing really to write home about. She looks good. Brett Ratner directed it. It's them performing at a little live thing. Uh-huh. Her writing some lyrics, laying on top of a car. You know, it's just basic. It's cute.
Yeah,
but basic.
Like, why is she writing the song right there? Last minute.
Girl, right? Yeah. But she looks good in it. And I do like the shots.
The hair's good.
That.
And I like the color of the blue of the sky.
Yes.
That's a good,
that is
sunset
good. Yeah.
Blue.
The coloration is good.
Yeah.
Very good.
I like the camo crocheted boob top.
Yes, that's a nice color.
And was she wearing camo pants too?
I think
or jeans. No, they're camo, weren't they?
Yeah, I think they were dark colored. Yeah. They were the same color as the top.
And the jacket comes on at the end?
Does it?
I think she would put the jacket
it's
on.
It's been a minute since I've watched this.
Me too.
I can't believe it. I can't believe it. I just admit. Okay. I haven't seen it in a while. Because you know what, to me, when I remembered when the video came out, the only interesting part of it was the first maybe minute. Mm. And then everything else was just boring to me.
What are her cell phone in it?
Right? Yeah.
Wasn't that big clunky?
Yeah. Big she was not laying. Yeah. Thing?
Yeah.
But that's when all the good clips came, mm-hmm. you know, of like her like writing and like her off of the stage. Mm-hmm. Those were the best parts of that video. Mm-hmm. But she looked gorgeous in it. The song went number one for 1 week. Thank God.
Yeah.
Because we needed it.
Well, I love the remix more.
Right. Now let's get into the remix. Make It Last. Thank God I Found You / Make It Last.
Yeah. Much sexier.
So sexy. So geniusly done again.
Yeah. Nas is
with
in it.
Nas and Joe.
Yeah.
But it's just a perfect mashup of all of that going on. Again, Mariah ahead of her time, mm-hmm. because that remix right there still holds up as fresh and current mm-hmm. to me. Mm-hmm. I think so.
Yeah.
And adding Nas to it was flawless. I mean, it's a genius move.
It kind of reminds me of like old school New York with clubs. You can like lounge around the club and jam out and sing. And
yeah, I get that.
Have a good time.
I think that remix video, though, was filmed in Germany.
It was, right?
Wasn't it? I think it was. But her braids and
the braids,
hats.
Cowboy hat.
Oh, and the top. I just love that whole look.
Uh-huh.
I just loved everything about that remix. I loved it better than the original.
I love her version.
So much better.
Oh, way much better. So much better.
So much better.
The version on the remix album, the remixes, mm-hmm. has like little extended ad-libs at the end of it.
Does it?
There's a little extra in that one.
I'm going to have to go back and revisit. Very minor. Only a hardcore lamb would notice that.
A Mariahologist would know.
A Mariahologist. Well, thank God you got it, because I would not have noticed that. I notice other things, though.
Do a side-by-side when you have a chance.
I will. Believe me, I will. And they performed...
Oh, I love the American Music
Awards. The American Music Awards was a great performance. She really showcased her diva by switching the ensemble.
Mid-song.
But coming out to the remix. Loved it.
No, I love when she starts the song, runs, comes back out in the mini dress, and she's like, doing her butt and like kind of wobbling in her stilettos.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh my God, is she going to tip?
Is she going to tip?
Yeah.
Is she going to? She has not like, you know.
She's not stable.
She was a little wobbly still. But that was so great.
I
mean, who else does that kind of stuff?
I know.
I mean, especially back then, like to change. Mariah didn't just like do a reveal.
Yeah.
She literally changed outfits.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. She didn't just like rip off a top or something. Like, you know, she didn't pull a Whitney Houston VMA moment where you just ripped off the bottom. Like, she literally did a quick change.
Yes.
In front of our eyes.
Uh-huh.
Behind the scenes, though. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Such a good moment.
Great, great performance. Great performance. But that, I think, brings us to the end now that we've covered everything. That was a short Thank God I Found You.
Did we miss anything about that? There's like a club mixy thing, right?
There's a celebratory mix that has like a faster club beat to it, which was cute. She did it at the homecoming special, which was cute. You know, there were cute moments around it. She was really excited to perform it on tour, and she performed it with Trey Lorenz on tour for the Rainbow Tour.
Mm-hmm.
And what else about Thank God I Found You? I think that's it.
It's
what it
cute.
Is. It stayed at number one for 1 week. What more could we say about it?
Yeah. It's a cute song.
It is a cute song. It is a cute song.
Rainbow.
Oh, Rainbow.
Love Rainbow.
Let's just bask in the glory of Rainbow for one more minute, though. Like, the whole era was so great. She really the straight hair.
The crochet
boots. Fashion. Now, you know those tops were handmade for her by her...
housekeeper, right?
Assistant. Not housekeeper, assistant.
Housekeeper did it.
I think it was her assistant. Because she traveled with her, so I'm sure she wasn't... And Mariah didn't technically have a house during this period. So I think her name was Arlene Arlette.
I thought it was...
Arlene or Arlette. I think Arlette.
Yeah. The boobs were new.
Yeah.
The boob era began.
The boob era began with the Tickle Bitties. Also, let's talk about how Rainbow is probably her most... the album with the most artists featured on it.
Oh,
like she has Jay-Z, Snoop Dogg, DeBrat, Missy, Usher, Mystical, Joe, 98 Degrees. I mean, that's like eight people.
Yeah.
That's pretty like, heavy. You know, heavy on that. But it all works.
Yeah.
It all works.
Totally.
I think the album overall, the flow, the whole story of it, it all really works. And Mariah's just a genius because how are you going to get a remix like the Heartbreaker remix and then you're going to flow right up into Against All Odds?
Mm-hmm.
It takes a genius to make that flow work, and she did it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's so good.
Yeah.
She made so many appearances.
Yeah.
She had so many performances.
She did.
There's just so much. Just good old days of Mariah taking the world by storm.
This album like lasted me years.
Well, it had to because Glitter didn't come out.
For ages. Oh, no, wait, like a year and a half.
Yeah, but in Mariah time,
that's a
long time.
Yeah.
That's a long time. Nowadays, a year and a half, a new album, sign my ass up. Now it's like every 10 years.
Yeah.
But she's a mother now, so she has to do what she has to do.
Okay, you have to take... You're going to jail, and you have to take one song off the album.
Oh, I mean, I'm going to take... Can't Take That Away.
Off the album.
Off the album? Yeah. Oh, I thought I was going to jail, and I could only take one me.
You have to... You can only get, like, 10 tracks or whatever. You have to take one off.
I have to take one off? Oh, I'm probably going to take off... I'm probably going to take off How Much.
Oh. I would take off Thank God I Found You.
You know, that would make sense too, because honestly, Petals would have been a perfect closeout.
Ending.
Would have been a perfect closeout.
The Rainbow Interlude.
Yeah, well, the Rainbow Interlude.
They're kind of the same song.
They're one and the same to me. So, but yeah, I see that. I could do that. I could do that too. I could do that too.
All right, you get to take one song forever to jail.
I can't take that away.
Can't take that away.
Yeah. There's some good ones, though.
Let me think real quick. Yeah, I agree.
That will get me through. It would get me through.
Yeah.
You can't have me up in the prison bars.
Or Petals. Ooh, hang on.
Ooh, or Petals. Oh. Oh, that's a tough one. Okay.
Quick, how, getting dragged in. Getting,
can't take that away. Can't take that away.
Yeah, I'll take that.
I'll
do it too.
Yeah.
All right.
I gotta go with it. But I just loved these past few weeks of reliving Rainbow.
I know. I think I'm going to put it back. like I said, on heavy rotation. Dig it up.
Yeah.
Keep it
I think so too. Lambs, you need to send us all of your lamb mail about this era. We've gotten some already, and we will reveal, we'll talk about those on moments and things to come in the future.
Yeah.
But relive this with us here because it's amazing. It's one of her best eras and a great, great album.
Yeah.
Where would this album fall as a whole in your Mariah top five of albums?
Four.
Okay. I could see that. Mine might be five.
Ooh.
Because,
what,
I mean,
what's
because
your
I need Butterfly. I need Daydream. I need Me, I Am Mariah. And this is in no particular order, I suppose, because this could all change depending on the minute, time, hour, and temperature outside.
Yeah.
And so I need those.
Oh, see, because, no, I need Butterfly, Emancipation, Me, I Am. But in my mind, they're like in a soup together. They're all like one unit.
Oh, they're like those prepackaged.
Three, and they're in a box set.
Yeah, they're in a box set. Yeah. Yeah.
But then Rainbow after that.
Okay.
Even though I love Rainbow so much, it was the first, it's when I signed the papers.
Yeah. I love Rainbow so much just for just the fun memories alone, just the era alone.
Yeah.
But the album, as we just discussed, is so
complex.
Complex and just built so well. Like you really see Mariah's artistry here.
Yeah.
And in all honesty, I do believe that a lot of her albums do tell stories.
Yeah.
This one is probably her most specific of storytelling.
Yeah.
But I think all of them, because she really always gives a lot into sequencing of the tracks and where they all fall. And obviously, you know, writing them and making them and singing them all, like, go into it, but it's all a story.
Mm-hmm.
It's all a story with a very happy rainbow at the end.
It is.
So I love it.
I know.
It's hard to say goodbye.
I know. I want to keep talking
it's
about
like
it.
It's like, but we gotta wrap it up.
I know.
This is like 17 hours of rainbow talk.
I know. Okay.
But thanks so much for joining us, Lamely.
Yeah. Thank you so much. This was so much fun.
It was a lot of fun. Give us
and
your
a long
feedback.
Time coming, right?
I know.
It's been 2 years, and I've always wanted to talk about Rainbow.
Yeah, it's a great time. I love the Rainbow.
Yeah.
If we missed any of your favorite Rainbow moments, let us know.
Yeah.
And we will definitely get into them.
Because she was all over Europe.
I know.
Doing
there's
TV.
So many.
Yeah.
And there's so many times that she was interacting with fans and meet and greets and all of this stuff. So it was really, really a good time. So send your stories, mariahreport@gmail.com, or you can Facebook us, tweet us, all of that jazz. And you can give us an iTunes review, which we love.
Oh, love those. It's our fave.
You just go on your iTunes.
The studio cat wants to come in.
Oh, I guess that means we're over if the studio cat's here.
It's here to get us out.
She's our studio time's up. She's coming in to take over. All right, Lance, that means it's the end of the rainbow era.
For now.
For now.
We can always dig it up again.
We're going to talk about more rainbow moments.
Yeah, why not?
Because there were some big ones.
Totally.
So. Hey, cat. I was going to call her the rainbow cat. Hey, rainbow cat, don't do that.
The guy's scratching the manager. All right, we gotta go.
Okay, Lance, thanks so much.
Thanks for listening.
Bye.